Now let's start with the prayers. You can repeat after me. Om Sadashiva Samarambham.
Om Sadashiva Samarambham.
Shankaracharya Madhyamam.
Shankaracharya Madhyamam.
Asmadacharya Paryantam.
अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तम्
वन्दे गुरु परम्पराम्
वन्दे गुरु परम्पराम्
सरस्वती नमस्तुभ्यम्
सरस्वती नमस्तुभ्यम्
वरदे कामरूपिणी
वरदे कामरूपिणी
विद्यारंभं करिष्यामि
विद्यारंभं करिष्यामि
सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा
सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा
ओम सहनाभवतु
ओम सहनाभवतु
सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै
सह वीर्यं करवावहै
तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै
ॐ
शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
So this, we said why to study Tattva Bodha, and of course moksha is one of the main, is the main goal of Tattva Bodha, and we said moksha has the fivefold benefits, okay, from the first class. And also we said that Tattva Bodha is a introductory text, so it is a good introduction to the technical terms of Vedanta. All the definitions of various words are given in a very systematic and simple manner in Tattva Bodha. So it is a good introduction. Okay. And these technical terms are called paribhasha. Okay. So to introduce us to these paribhasha, we are starting with Tattva Bodha. Now, today we are starting the first verse, the first line of Tattva Bodha. And this we will read and then we will go. We will see the explanation. Okay, so this you can repeat after me. Vasudevendra Yogindram.
Vasudevendra Yogindram.
Vasudevendra Yogindram.
Vasudevendra
Yogindram. Natva Jnana Pradam Gurum.
Natva Jnana Pradam Gurum.
Natva Jnana Pradam Gurum.
Natva Jnana Pradam Gurum.
Mumukshunam Hitarthaya.
Mumukshunam
Hitarthaya.
Mumukshunam Hitarthaya.
Mumukshunam Hitarthaya.
Tattva Bodho Bhidhiyate.
Tattva
Bodho Vidhiyate.
Tattva Bodho Vidhiyate.
Now I will mute everybody and we will see the meaning. Okay, so as you can see, this first verse of Tattva Bodha is in verse form. Okay, verse form means that it is in a metered way, like a poetry, a couplet, right? So this particular verse is called Anushtup Chandaha. Chandaha means a meter, and Anushtup is the name of this particular meter. When any verse is in meter form, you can sing it. There's a particular tune you can follow. Okay, and this Anushtup Chandaha, in fact, almost 70% of Bhagavad Gita is in Anushtup Chandaha. Okay, this particular tune that we followed. And in Anushtup Chandaha, in this, the Chanda and the metering of Sanskrit verses, they count the syllables. Okay, so for every verse, there is a fixed number of syllables. In Anushtup, it is 32. Total 32. Okay, so the first quarter line will have 8, 8, 8, 8. So 8 into 4, 32. Okay, and in Tattva Bodha, only the first and the last are in this verse form. Okay, everything else in between is in prose form. Prose means like a statement. Only the first and the last are in Anushtup Chandaha in the verse form. You can sing it. All the other lines in Tattva Bodha, you just have to read it like how you would read statements. Now, let us come to the meaning of this verse. So basically, this is a prayer verse. Okay, it is an invocatory or prayer verse. In Sanskrit, we call it a Prarthana Shloka or a Mangala Shloka. Okay, so the author is starting with a prayer. Okay, he is invoking the Lord before he starts with this text. Now, in India, you may have observed that for everything we do, there is some puja or prayer associated. Those of you who have been to any function of any sort, we start with a Ganesha Shloka, right? Most functions start like that. And if you know about Ayudha Puja, Ayudha Puja is a day where all the weapons are worshipped. Weapons meaning all your tools or instruments that help you in your day-to-day life, all these things are worshipped. Okay, and in fact, everything we do in Indian culture, prayer becomes a very important and unique feature. And those of you who have been to the Shivananda Ashram, in fact, we have some Karma Yogis from Shivananda Neyyar Dam. You can ask them, they will tell you everything there is a prayer involved. Okay, so if before a class, there is a prayer. At the end of class, there is a prayer. Before you eat, there is a prayer. Before you go for a walk, there is a prayer. If it is your birthday, there is a prayer. And if somebody passes away, again, there is a prayer. Okay, so for every activity, a prayer is involved. Okay, and so developing this prayerful attitude is very important. The question might come, why? Why should I, have a prayerful attitude? So there are many reasons. One reason is because, as we will go on in the study, we will see that this whole world is a manifestation of the Lord. The whole world is Brahman. The whole world is Ishvara. And when that is the case, you have to start seeing the Lord in everything, not just in some things, but in everything. So this prayerful attitude will help you take one step towards that. Another important reason is it helps to inculcate the habit of Karma Yoga. Now, what is Karma Yoga? This You will see in great detail in Bhagavad Gita, there is a whole chapter dedicated to Karma Yoga. But just to tell you quickly, Karma Yoga is not 1 hour of selfless service or any of these things. Okay, so Karma Yoga is not about the activity that you do. It is about the attitude with which you do any activity. And so the aim is to convert all activity into prayer. So prayer becomes a very important part of Karma Yoga. It is one of the very important aspects. This developing this prayerful attitude, and you know, ultimately this leads to what we call Chitta Shuddhi. Chitta Shuddhi is basically a reduction in your FIR. We discussed this in the first class. What is FIR?
And reaction, frequency, intensity, and reaction
of
emotions, emotional letdown or the anger, like
yes, emotional turbulence.
Yeah.
Okay, so to bring this down over a period of time, Karma Yoga attitude becomes very important, and you can, with the attitude of Karma Yoga, you can convert any action you do into a prayer or into a worship. And so this prayerful attitude becomes very important to develop Chitta Shuddhi. Okay, to reduce the emotional disturbances in the mind. Okay, and there is a third important reason also. So any activity you do depends on two factors. The success of that activity depends on two things. The first thing is your own effort into that activity. We call this as prayatna, your effort. And there is a second factor which we call as Ishwara Anugraha, okay, or God's grace. Basically, all the other external uncontrollable factors, these things we call as God's grace. Now, you know, there are many things that are out of our control totally, right? We can't control earthquakes. We can't control monsoon. We can't control power cuts. So many things in life that we cannot control, right? But still, you can have an effort. So always the success of any action is a resultant, force between these two things. It's a resultant, a mix of these two things. You can't always predict which one will win, but these two will always mix, and then there is a result. And these two things we said, effort and God's grace. And later, when you study the law of karma, you will know them by different names. You will call them as Agami Karma and as Prarabdha Karma. Okay, so for example, you know, if there is a power cut, what can be your effort? You can get a generator or a inverter installed at your house. So even if there is a power cut, still your the effects on you are somewhat mitigated, right? So your efforts mitigate that situation, the consequences of that situation. Still totally not in your control, but you know, some balance is there. Suppose the power cut is for 8 hours and your generator backup is only for 6 hours. Still, it is better, right? You only have to suffer 2 hours of a power cut. But if the power cut is for 4 hours and your generator backup is for 6 hours, then it is okay. No problem at all, right? So in this way, always your effort mitigates any situation. And in Shastra, we say that prayer is one such very important effort to mitigate the consequences of any situation, to handle any situation. So to alter these external uncontrollable factors, prayer becomes a very important tool. Okay, later you will see that this is called Agami Karma, and prayer comes under the classification of Agami Karma. It is a conscious, deliberate action that you take, and therefore it will have a consequence. And generally, towards favoring you, okay, favoring what you wanted, the prayer will, help in that way to alter these uncontrollable factors. So always, in this culture, this prayerful attitude is emphasized. It is taught by the parents. You see it in temples, you see it in ashrams. More and more, this attitude is tried to be, imbibed into you. Okay, so here also, we can see that the author has started with a prayer. Okay, so the author has taken up a big project. He wants to write a book called Tattva Bodha. And now, before he starts, he is praying so that there are no obstacles to his project and he can complete it successfully. And with him, we also join in this prayer, because our project now is to complete the study of Tattva Bodha without any obstacles. Right? So we also join him in his prayers. Now let us look at the meaning of the verse, the words. So he says, Vasudevendra. Okay, the word breaks here. The first word is Vasudevendra. This is a name. Okay, it is the name of somebody called Vasudevendra. Who is Vasudevendra? He's the author's teacher, Gurum. The last word says Gurum. So this Vasudevendra is the teacher of the author. Now there are many interesting points that come out of this. Okay, so let's look at some of them. So he has started the text by offering a prayer to his guru. So in this lineage, in this culture, we say that guru is equal to God. Okay, so guru is as good as is a manifestation of the Lord himself. So a prayer to the guru is as good as a prayer to the Lord. And that is what the author has done. He has offered a prayer to his guru. Okay. And this is treated as being a prayer to the Lord also. Why? Because the guru is a manifestation of the Lord himself. Okay. So this is one important point that comes out. The second point that comes out is that the author has actually not mentioned his name anywhere in the text. Okay. So in the whole text, the author's name is not given. The only thing we know is that he had a guru called Vasudevendra. And, so if you actually ask who is the author of Tattva Bodha, the answer is we actually don't know. Okay. So it is believed that it could be Shankaracharya, or it could be one of the Acharyas in the Shankaracharya lineage later on. Okay. One of the other, teachers of that parampara. Suppose it was one of the later Acharyas, then we can take this Vasudevendra to mean his guru's name. Okay. So his direct teacher's name, we can take it to mean Vasudevendra. Suppose you take it as Adi Shankaracharya who wrote this Tattva Bodha, then Adi Shankaracharya's teacher's name is not Vasudevendra, right? So in that case, we will take Vasudevendra to mean Krishna. Vasudevendra is another name for Krishna, right? And as we all know, Krishna is also a teacher. He's also a guru. So this can be taken that time as a prayer to Krishna himself, as the teacher and giver of knowledge. Okay, so two possibilities. It's open to interpretation. You can take it however you like, but the author's name is not mentioned. Okay, so we don't know who wrote it, when they wrote it. None of these details are available to us.
Ma'am, on the textbook that you sent us, on the top of the first page, it says, Om Shri Gurave Namah, and then the second it says Atha Shri Shankaracharya Virachita.
Yeah, it says that, but like I said, there are different interpretations, and we don't know which Shankaracharya it is. No, Adi Shankaracharya is not the only person with that name. Later in his lineage, there are many Shankaracharyas who came up. So it could be one of those Shankaracharyas. We don't know. Okay. So this is about Vasudevendra Yogindra. Vasudevendra, who is the guru. Now, there are actually some more interesting points that come out just from these two words, okay? So one of the important subtle takeaways from this part, from him acknowledging his teacher, is that the author is indirectly saying that, see, this is not my teaching. I didn't invent this. I didn't create this. I didn't come up with this. I am just teaching it to you the way my teacher taught it to me. The knowledge actually belongs to the Guru Parampara. And this attitude you will see in all the acharyas of the lineage. Okay, nobody will ever claim that this is my teaching. All of them will give credits only to their teachers. Why? Because the knowledge has come from them. Nobody created this knowledge. Right? So this disillusion, in a sense, of this feeling that I am teaching this goes away. Okay, more and more it becomes, I am just teaching to you the way my teacher told me. Okay, so this is another important takeaway from this, that the knowledge actually does not belong to any one person. You cannot attribute it to any one person. It belongs to the Guru Parampara, and it is passed down from teacher to student, teacher to student. Okay, so this is another important understanding from this. This is what the author is trying to express. Another important point that comes out from this is that the study is not to be taken up independently. Okay, it's very important to have a guru or a teacher. Here also from this, again, this is another indirect way that the author is telling you, don't go studying the scriptures independently. Okay, scriptures are not meant for independent study. This can become a dangerous activity. Okay, why? Because there are a lot of, tricky words, tricky translations in the study. And there is a lot of navigation that has to be done. You have to be shown how to do it. Otherwise, what happens? It is prone to a lot of, misinterpretation, wrong conclusions. So it is one thing if, you read some scripture and then you don't get any knowledge, that is still okay. But suppose you take away the wrong conclusion and then you implement that wrong conclusion in life, it can lead to a lot of problems, lot of conflict, lot of confusion. It can lead to chaos in your mind, and then you will end up totally disillusioned with the scripture. Why? All because, you started using it wrong. So this is why a teacher becomes very important. Okay, so one of the other things that a teacher does is that they teach you how to navigate. Okay, so they teach you how to systematically unfold the subject. So, suppose you walk into a big library full of Vedanta books. Okay, and you have no background, no clue, nothing. You just walk into a library, it's filled with Vedanta books. Do you know which book to select first and start reading that? No idea, right? You don't know which one to even start with. And then what happens if you pick something randomly and then you read and then something else randomly and then you read? It is like watching a movie from the middle. You just click somewhere on the movie, then you go front, then you go back, and then you just keep shifting. Would the movie make sense to you? No, right? It will be total chaos. To watch a movie, you have to watch from the beginning in that order till the end, right? Then only the whole thing makes sense. In the same way with Vedanta or with any spiritual study, you always have to start at the starting point and then end at the ending point and go in a particular order, particular sequence. And that sequence, that unfoldment, that is offered by the teacher. Okay, so for example, in these classes, we are starting with Tattva Bodha, right? Then we are moving to Bhagavad Gita. Then we are moving to Upanishads. Directly, we are not starting Upanishads. Upanishads will come at least 4 or 5 years from this point. Okay, so it is an advanced study and you require that much preparation to, you know, understand and digest Upanishads. Directly, if you start reading Upanishads, it will not make any sense. Okay. And then there is another important reason. Many times in scriptures, what happens is that there is a contradiction or a seeming contradiction. In Bhagavad Gita only, many times it happens that Krishna says one thing, then later he says the opposite. Okay. So he says somewhere do something and later on the same thing he says don't do it. Now, isn't that confusing? If you know the same person, same Bhagavad Gita, they're telling you do and then don't do. It gets confusing. How do you resolve these contradictions? How do you understand, right? So this resolving the conflict between the statements of the Shastra, which appear to be contradicting, but actually you have to extract the correct understanding. That is done by the teacher. That knowledge, that understanding is given by the teacher. Okay, and so that is another reason why a teacher becomes important. And the third reason why the teacher becomes important is to translate the words correctly. Okay, so in Sanskrit, it's a very contextual language, meaning that the words change their meaning depending on which sentence or how they are used. Okay, so the same word can have multiple meanings in different sentences. For example, you take the word Atma. Okay, there are at least 4 meanings of the word Atma that I can think of. Now, which meaning of the word Atma to take? And they're all quite different, okay, from each other. They're all different 4 meanings. And suppose I come across the word Atma. Which Atma are we talking about? Right, so it becomes important to understand which meaning to take where. And that interpretation is given by the teacher correctly. Okay, and that is why a teacher becomes very important and independent self-study of scriptures is not at all recommended. Okay, so this much we got from just 2 words, Vasudevendra and Guru. Okay, any questions? Are you all awake at least?
Yes.
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 Okay.
I have one question.
Yes.
What is the best way to take notes since we are starting? Like,
what is the best way to?
To take notes on this topic. Like, just, you know, I'm just scribbling down points that I'm understanding. But what is the best way so that if I go back to it, I understand it? Like, so is there any way that you can suggest in which I should sort of note down?
You will have to come back and listen to the recording again. So during the class, it becomes difficult to take full notes because, you know, we keep moving fast and you can't write at that speed. But since the recording is being sent out to you, during the week, you are expected to go back, listen again to the recording. If you have questions, write them down. Write down your notes and think over the topics. So the 1 week gap is given for you to do mananam, this thinking over process. Okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Fine. So then let's move on. Okay. So we saw the word Vasudevendra and we saw Guru. So Vasudevendra is the teacher of the author and he has given a description of this Vasudevendra and he calls him Yogindram. Okay, this word is basically a combination of two words, yogi plus indram. Okay, indram is a suffix that is attached when you want to say great. Okay, whenever the word indram comes at the end of a word, it just indicates great. Okay, and great what? Yogi. So yogindram means great yogi. So this Vasudevendra is a great yogi. Now what does yogi mean here? Okay, so it is not a hatha yogi who can do all advanced asanas. That is not the meaning here. Here yogi means jnani. Okay, the wise person, the enlightened person. Okay, jnani. So he is an enlightened one and he is a great jnani. So Vasudevendra Yogindram. This is the qualification for the teacher whose name is Vasudevendra. There is one more interpretation. So if you take Vasudevendra Yogindram as one word, as one name, then it can be one of the acharyas of the Kanchi Matha. Okay, so the Kanchi Matha is one of the pitas supposed to be established by Adi Shankaracharya. And so you all know, so you have Swami Shivananda Saraswati, Swami Vishnudevananda Saraswati. Like that, that Saraswati tag that comes at the end indicates, you know, where they belong, and there's a classification among them, okay? And one of the classifications is Indram. Okay, so it belongs to the Kanchi Matha Parampara when the Indram tag comes. So if you take the whole name, whole thing as one name, then it could be one of the teachers from the Kanchi Parampara. Or if you take it as two ways, Vasudevendra and Yogindram, then there is a teacher called Vasudevendra who is a great yogi. Both ways are okay. Since we don't know who is the author and who is the teacher, this both interpretations are acceptable. Okay. So natva. Natva means having offered my namaskara. Okay, it comes from the word namaha. Namaha means to offer namaskar. So natva means having offered my namaskara to this Vasudevendra Yogindra. And what is the, you know, who is this Vasudevendra Yogindra? He is my teacher, he is my guru. And what did he do? Jnana Pradam. He has given me knowledge. Pradam means to give. Jnana means knowledge. And here, Jnanam, knowledge, does not refer to any worldly knowledge. Okay? It does not refer to physics or mathematics. It refers to Atma Jnanam, self-knowledge, knowledge about Atman. So this teacher, this Vasudevendra, who is a great yogi, who is my teacher, I bow down to him and offer my namaskara because he has given me self-knowledge. Is this clear, the first line?
Yes.
Any questions? Okay, then we will see the meaning of the second line. He says, Mumukshu Naam Hitarthaya. Okay. Mumukshu is somebody who wants moksha. Okay. Mumukshu is somebody who desires moksha. And Hitarthaya means for the benefit of. So for the benefit of those who want moksha. That is the meaning of mumukshu naam hitarthaya. If you take the word hitarthaya, hita plus arthaya. Okay, hita means benefit, artha means purpose. So hita artha means for the purpose of benefiting the mumukshus, that is those who want moksha. So for the purpose of helping out these mumukshus, what has the author done? Tattva bodho abhidiyate. The word breaks here. And tattva bodha abhidiyate. I am presenting this text called tattva bodha. So for the benefit of the mumukshus, I am presenting this text called tattva bodha. Okay. Now, just once, interesting note. You see this S symbol here, no? This S here. This is called an avagraha. And it is just a grammatical construct. Basically, when you join in, there are some grammar rules. When you join two particular kind of words, that symbol comes. Okay, it has no pronunciation. It basically indicates that there used to be an akara here. Okay, so this is grammar. Need not worry about it too much. So it just indicates that this a used to be here. That's all. Okay, so this word becomes abhidiyate when you break it. When you join it, that S symbol comes, the A vanishes, and you don't pronounce it at all. Okay, so tattva bodha abhidiyate. So I'm presenting, abhidiyate means to present or to give. So I'm giving you or presenting you with this text called tattva bodha. Now, tattva bodha, in the very first class, we discussed the meaning of the word tattva bodha. What does it mean?
Buddha means knowledge and tattva means essence.
Tattva means
self knowledge. Essence, reality.
True nature.
Reality. Yes.
So, knowledge about your own self or knowledge about your own reality. That is what is tattva bodha, the meaning. Now, why does the author feel the need to talk about the reality of who you are? This is because that the sense organs or your perception need not always be reality. Okay? Perception can be different from reality. What does that mean? So, for example, look at the table in front of you. Okay, the table appears solid, dense, right? But physics tells us that inside this table, it is made up of atoms, right? Molecules, atoms. And now they tell us that every atom is basically 90% empty space. Okay? And then only 10% is all the subatomic particles like the protons, electrons, neutrons, all these things. So basically, 90% empty space, 10% subatomic particles, approximately. And even those subatomic particles, your electrons and all that, when you go investigate deeper, you find out that they are also made up of other things, leptons and quarks and whatnot. And finally, physics now says that basically all these subatomic particles are nothing but energy in motion. Okay, so the reality of this desk, of this table, is 90% empty space plus 10% of energy in motion. Okay, it's hard to conceive, no? Because the table appears solid in front of you, but inside it is mostly empty space and it seems energy. So it is tough to reconcile this. So, you know, finally the conclusion is that your sense organs don't always report the real nature of something to you. Okay. Another example, suppose, you know, we take sunrise. We say that the sun rises. Does the sun actually rise?
No, it appears.
Yeah. So what is actually happening?
The earth is moving.
The earth that is moving around the sun.
Right. The earth revolving on its own axis. And that is why it appears as though the sun is moving around us. Actually, the sun is not moving anywhere. The earth is moving, but it appears as though the sun is moving. So if you just go by what your eyes tell you alone, right? If you just go with perception alone, you will come to the conclusion that the sun is rising and then the sun is moving and finally setting. It feels as though the sun is going around the world. But that we have now discovered is not the case. Actually, the earth is moving and then the sun just appears as though it is moving. Okay, so it is not that your perception is negated or contradicted. It is just that there is a shift in your intellectual understanding, right? Because of knowledge. So this is why Tattva Bodha is needed. Because perception need not always reveal reality. Okay? And that is why Shastra has taken up this project of revealing reality to us. Because it is not possible to be revealed with sense organs alone. Right? Any questions? No questions? So whenever there's no questions, I get a doubt. Did you understand everything or did you understand nothing?
Midway.
Understanding it very well. Meghaji, we are understanding it very well. Thank you so much.
All clear.
Okay, fine. So then we will move on to the next verse. Okay, so this was the prayer verse. Basically, the author starts with a prayer to his teacher whose name is Vasudevendra. He said, okay, O Vasudevendra, you are a great yogi. You are my teacher and you have given me knowledge and I bow down to you. I offer my namaskara to you. And for the benefit of mumukshus, I am going to present this text called Tattva Bodha, which reveals the reality of who you are. Okay, that is the rough translation of this verse. Now in the next line, the first line, the author is introducing the text Tattva Bodha. Okay, now we have already done our introduction in the very first class, but the author doesn't know that. So he is giving his introduction, which we will read now. So you can unmute yourself and repeat after me. Sadhana chatushtaya.
Sadhana chatushtaya.
Sampannadhikarinam.
Sampannadhikarinam.
Moksha sadhana bhutam.
Moksha sadhana bhutam.
Tattva viveka prakaram.
Tattva viveka prakaram.
Vakshyamaha.
Vakshyamaha.
All right, so now the author has given his introduction of the text. And before we see that, I just want to bring your attention to this word, Vakshyamaha. Vakshyamaha means we will tell you. Now it is an interesting choice of word because the author didn't say Vakshyami. In Sanskrit, Vakshyami means I will tell you. And Vakshyamaha means we will tell you, plural, okay? So again, in a very subtle way, he is acknowledging the Guru Parampara. So when he says, we will tell you, he's not saying, I will tell you this knowledge. He's telling, the Guru Parampara is telling you this knowledge. It has come from all the teachers of the Guru Parampara. And I am acknowledging this. And so we will tell you, because it is not my knowledge alone. Okay, so again, in a very subtle way, he is acknowledging and showing his gratitude to the Guru Parampara. Now, what is he going to tell us? So, we will just move to the next slide and I will tell you. Okay, so here, the author in the introduction, the very first verse, line of Tattva Bodha, he is answering, he's raising three questions and answering the three questions. Okay, so actually there are no questions. We have imagined the questions to understand his statements. So he asks, in a way, you know, subtly raises three questions and answers them. What are those three questions? The first one, he says, what is the subject of this book that he is writing? And that is answered in the statement, Tattva Viveka Prakaram. Okay, and the second question, he asks, what is the purpose of this study? He says, Moksha Sadhana Bhutam. And for whom is this study intended? For the Adhikari student. Now let us see. The first one, he says, what is the subject? And the subject is Tattva Viveka Prakaram. Now, Tattva again basically means the reality or the self or Atma. You can take it to mean Atma, the reality. Viveka means analysis or inquiry or discrimination or discernment. Okay? And Prakaram means a method. So Tattva Viveka Prakaram means a method of inquiry into the reality, into myself. So the subject of the book is to inquire into this who am I question. So when you do self-inquiry, it results in self-knowledge, right? So that is the understanding. Now you may have this question that what is the need for me to inquire into myself? I already know who I am. Okay, but here Shastra says no. You think you know who you are, but you don't know who you are. Okay, and that is why this becomes necessary. So ignorance on its own, you know, need not be a problem. Okay, ignorance on its own is not exactly a problem. The problem is not ignorance alone. The problem is misconception about who we are. Okay, so the classic example given is of the rope and the snake. Okay, so suppose you are walking on a path in the evening. It is about to be dark. And in the dull light, you see something on the road. And you think it is a snake. Now, actually, it is not a snake. It is a rope. But because of the dull light, you think it is a snake. Now, see this, you know, interesting thing. If you had seen the rope very clearly, that this is a rope, there would have been no problem. If you had not seen anything at all, if it was total darkness and you had not seen anything at all, again, there is no problem. The problem arises in this in-between half-knowledge state. There is something there, but I don't know what it is. So now I think it is a snake. And then the problem starts. The fear, the panic, the misery, all these things start. This is a very important example in Vedanta because this is what we have done in life with ourselves. Not only do we not know who we are, we mistakenly think we are something else, like the rope and the snake example. And because of this half knowledge, all the misery arises. Okay, because of this, you know, in-between state. If there was total knowledge about who I am, it is still, you know, it's still okay. If there was total ignorance also, still there is no problem. But the problem is not only do I not know who I am, I have superimposed something else on top of that. And I think I am that superimposed thing. And that is why there is a misconception or an erroneous conclusion. There is an error in my understanding. And that is where all the problem starts. Okay. And that is why Tattva Viveka Prakaram becomes necessary. An analysis, kind of a discrimination between all these things, kind of differentiating this much is not me, this much is me. This kind of analysis finally resulting in self-knowledge is what the subject of Tattva Bodha is. And that is what the author is saying. Okay, Tattva Viveka Prakaram. Is this clear? Any questions?
Yes, Medhaji, clear.
Yes. Okay, fine. So next, what is the purpose of this study? So obviously, if you do self-inquiry, you will get self-knowledge, right? And this self-knowledge is basically Atmajnanam, which we said is moksha. And what is moksha? Those five benefits from the first class. Okay, I'm not going to go there again. You can go back and listen to the first class. So this, the purpose is moksha. Moksha sadhana bhutam. Sadhana means a means. Okay, so a means to moksha. Bhutam means of the form of. So it is of the form of the means to moksha. So basically the purpose is moksha. And what is moksha? Those five benefits. In very simplistic words, it means permanent happiness. Happiness that is unaffected by whatever else happens in life. Permanent happiness. So this is moksha. Simple understanding. Okay, so that this is the purpose of the study. And for whom is it? It is for the adhikari student. Now, the word adhikar is there in Hindi and other languages also. And in Hindi, it means right. Like, you know, to have a right to do something. Like haq hai. Okay, but here that is not the meaning. Okay, at this point, again, I want to tell that please keep aside all knowledge of words from Hindi and other languages that you know, because it will only result in confusion. Most of the time, the Sanskrit word meanings, especially in this text, they are quite different. Okay, so it is better to keep aside your old understanding of these words to avoid confusion. Okay, and take the meaning what is being given here. Okay, so the word adhikari here means.
Adhikari. What is
1 minute. Is somebody asking something? Okay. So here the word adhikari does not mean right, it means eligibility. Okay, so when we say adhikari, it means an eligible student. There's no entitlement here. There is only merit-based eligibility. And the author has, qualified this further. If you ask who is an eligible student, then he has given some qualities. In the previous line, he says, sadhana chatushtaya sampanna adhikari. Okay, so the adhikari is one who has sadhana chatushtayam. Sampanna, the word sampanna here means endowed with or possessing. Okay, so the adhikari is one who is possessing sadhana chatushtayam. Sadhana chatushtayam means fourfold qualifications. This is the eligibility criteria, okay, in order to be eligible for this jnanam. So just like how when you apply for a master's course, the eligibility criteria is a bachelor's degree, right? Without having a bachelor's degree, nobody will accept you into the master's program, right? So in the same way, here for this study, what is expected is sadhana chatushtayam. Once you have this sadhana chatushtayam, these fourfold qualifications, then you become an adhikari or eligible student. Okay, is this clear?
Chatushtayam, can you say it again?
Sorry, which one?
Chatushtayam.
Chatushtayam. Sadhanam, yeah. Chatushtayam. Chatushtayam means four. Sadhana means, here it means qualifications. Okay. So four qualifications.
Thank you.
Is this clear to everyone? Any questions? We're going to stop here for today. And in the next class, we're going to see what is Sadhana Chatushtayam. Okay, what are those four qualities that every eligible student requires? That we will see in the next class. Today we are stopping here. So the author has, in his introductory line, he has covered three things. He says, for the eligible student, the eligible student is one who has these four qualifications. For this person, a means of moksha is being presented. And how? By analysis into the self, a method of inquiry into the reality. Okay, so we're going to inquire. The result is, the final goal is moksha. And what do you need for this? You need Sadhana Chatushtayam. What is Sadhana Chatushtayam? Next class. Any questions?
Thank you.
I hope this was clear and no confusions.
Okay, clear. Thank you. Megaji, thank you.
Okay. Fine. So we will stop now and end with the prayer. No questions, right?
Yeah.
Purnamada, all together. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Om Shanti Shanti Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om Om Tat Sat. Thank you all and see you next week.
Thank you, Medhaji.
Thank you.
Thank you, Medhaji.
Thank you.
Thank you, Medhaji.